Slavna američka aktivistkinja, filozofkinja i revolucionarka Angela Davis u sklopu Subverziv festivala održala je predavanje pred punim auditorijem Velike dvorane Vatroslava Lisinskog. Predavanje koje je pohodilo skoro 1500 posjetitelja, kao i razgovor koji je slijedio sa aktivistkinjom i istraživačicom Eminom Bužinkić te članicom odbora Subverziv foruma Karolinom Hrgom donosimo u cijelosti.
Professor Davis, the floor is yours.
I think I would like to begin by, first of all, greeting all of you and telling you how happy I am to be in the city of Zagreb in Croatia. Before I begin, I think it might be appropriate, given the ongoing genocide in Gaza, for all of us to take a minute of silence to reflect on what we might do to end this genocide. Thank you. Once again, let me say how happy I am to be here this evening to participate in the 17th Subversive Film Festival and Forum here in Zagreb. But I must also say that I deeply regret that it has taken me so long to actually get here. The first invitation extended to me by Karolina Hrga and the organizers. Did I say your name correctly?
Quite properly.
Okay. Hrga. The first invitation came in 2018. So I have actually been looking forward to this trip for the last 5 years, especially since I've been aware of the feminist movement here, its insistence on anti-capitalist theory and practice. So many thanks to all of the organizers of the festival for allowing me to participate this year at such a pivotal moment in our collective history. I'm looking forward to the conversation with Karolina and Emina and with the audience, with all of you. So I will try to speak for about a half an hour. I may go over. I tend to veer away from my notes, but I will be aware of that. And I want to frame my remarks first with a few observations on the ongoing genocide in Gaza. And I would like to begin by saying that our various responses to the war in Gaza now serve as a measure not only of what we are doing in order to forge solidarity with Palestine, but rather also of how we are progressing in all of our struggles, struggles against racial capitalism, struggles against heteropatriarchy, against the systematic pollution of the planet for purposes of profits. I also want to emphasize that that it might be helpful to take our leadership from the Palestinian people, who have always stood up and fought back at every point since the Nakba of 1948, even as they have mourned the immense tragedies that have accompanied the settler colonialist efforts to build and sustain the state of Israel. I understand that one of my books, Freedom is a Constant Struggle, has been translated into Croatian. And I must admit, I'm entirely mystified by this language. I've been listening to it, and I love the sound, but having studied French and German and Spanish, that does not seem to be helpful here. So, the full title of the book that was translated is Freedom is a Constant Struggle, Palestine, Ferguson, and the Foundations of a Movement. It was published, I believe, in 2016. And at that time, many scholar activists in the US were welcoming a new moment in the history of Black radical movement. The emergence of what we refer to now as the Black Lives Matter movement. And the developing bonds between the Black movement in the US and the Palestine Solidarity Movement. The Ferguson protests against the 2014 police murder of a young Black man by the name of Michael Brown was the occasion of the emergence of this new conjecture, I would call it. These protests seem to be, on the one hand, a reenactment of countless other protests since the end of slavery in the 19th century. Protest against police violence, protest against racist vigilante violence. There were a number of ways, however, in which this moment was very different. And in that context, I want to highlight the fact that this moment revealed a developing and explicit feminist consciousness. The feminist dimensions differentiated this moment, this movement, from other protests of the past, not only because women were in the forefront of the movement, but also through the emergence at that time of a more inclusive and expansive understanding, popular understanding, at least among movement activists, of the category of women, including, of course, trans women, non-binary people, and others who were increasingly insisting on the need to challenge the binary structure of gender. Now, historically in the US, and probably in most parts of the world, women do the work that is not acknowledged. Women do housework, and I like to refer to organizing as the housework of the movement. And so women are responsible for organizing movements, and always have been. This was the very first time that the leadership of movements was placed into question, was challenged. This was the first time that the feminist notion of collective leadership began to broadly resonate. During the 1960s, Ella Baker, if any of you are familiar with the participants in the, you know, what we call the civil rights movement, Ella Baker, who was the major mentor for the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, SNCC, the youth organization associated with the civil rights movement, Ella Baker had proposed a form of collective leadership as an alternative to the assumption that Dr. Martin Luther King was the best model of leadership. And this is not in any way to question the phenomenal contributions that Dr. King made to the movement. But it is to point out that conventional leadership model, which was male, individualistic, charismatic, that this model of leadership was being questioned. The emergent feminist dimensions of this movement included an internationalism also at the very outset. This is to say that its focus on racist police violence incorporated a new consciousness of the militarization of the police and the role played by the Israeli army in producing this militarization through, for example, extensive training programs of police departments all over the country. Some of you may be aware of the fact that it was determined, if you remember the Ferguson protests. I can't really see you that well, so I can't see the generational composition of the audience this evening. But some of you may remember the Ferguson protests in 2012. It was determined that the police force of that small suburban town had been trained by the IDF. You can say that since the 19th century, black people in the U.S. have been standing up to challenge racist police violence and its links to formations like the Ku Klux Klan. But this was the first time in which it became clear that in order to mount effective resistance, it would be necessary to contextualize police violence in relation to the growing Islamophobia in the world linked to the so-called war on terror, and to identify the state of Israel and its settler colonial strategies, not only in relation to its decades of military violence against Palestinians, but also in its role of enabling increasingly militaristic and racist police forces in the US and elsewhere in the world. So, the point that I would like to make is that this more complicated analysis of police violence, which allowed us to escape this sort of cycle of mobilizing around individual instances of police violence over and over and over again, calling for justice, of which in many events which in many cases involved efforts to prosecute the individual police officer responsible for the killing. This more complex analysis of police violence is linked to a growing feminist consciousness. And let me be clear, I'm not referring to what we used to call white bourgeois feminism, what is sometimes today called, those who want to puncture the ceiling, expressed by such figures as Hillary Clinton and others. Glass ceiling, yeah, thank you. Glass ceiling feminism, thank you very much. Glass ceiling feminism. Those who can already see the top of the hierarchy through the glass, those who have already traveled so far as to be able to position themselves almost at the top, but not quite, and all they need to do is puncture the ceiling. You know, not a kind of abstract feminism that in which the universality, the presumed universality, is actually internally raced as white, but rather an anti-capitalist, socialist, anti-racist feminism that is especially interested in how to guarantee that poor and working class women move up. And that is situated in the context of the interrelationality of struggles around race and class and gender and nation and the planet. At the time, this book we were referring to, Freedom is a Constant Struggle, at the time that book was published, it was clear that there were conditions of possibility for more robust and interconnected movements. We could see the foundations for new movements, but it wasn't really clear whether those movements would actually develop. You know, sometimes possibilities emerge, and it's decades before they are realized, if they are realized at all. I was referring to Ella Baker, who initiated a series of conversations with the colleagues of Dr. Martin Luther King and students about the need to think explicitly about the nature of leadership. It was the students who were more interested in the possibilities of a different kind of leadership, what I would say is a feminist notion of collective leadership. But that did not begin to resonate widely until the Ferguson protest and the conversations that happened around that. So that's like 50 years later. It took almost half a century for these ideas to resonate. At the same time, we're talking about the Ferguson era, at the same time, Palestinian activists were in the forefront of an international movement of solidarity with black radical struggles against racist violence. And many of you may know that during the Ferguson protests, Palestinian activists on the ground in Palestine watching images of the protests on social media were able to see the brand name of the tear gas canisters that were used against the demonstrators. And they notice that this tear gas was exactly the same tear gas that was used in Palestine, literally. And so they contacted activists in the US and in Ferguson, and they explained, and I should say that there were also Palestinian American protesters. Many people assume when they hear about the protests that all of the protesters were black, and that was not the case, and it's never been the case. There have been people who are not black who have been involved in every black movement. So I say this in order to challenge us to think beyond identitarian notions of race and gender and so forth, and to look at the larger picture. So when black students in the US, this is around 2012, 2013, began to demonstrate on behalf of Palestinians, and when black feminists took up the cause of Palestine, it was based on an affinity generated through common struggle. If I had time, I would try to propose a genealogy that might help us to understand the way in which Palestine solidarity became a key element of black feminist struggle that might include, for example, the 1985 United Nations conference, women's conference in Nairobi. Are you familiar with the series of, you know, the conference that took place in 1975, which was supposed to be a year, and the debates around that, those who argued that war was not really a feminist issue, although we know, especially you here in Croatia, are aware of the role that women played in challenging war and challenging fascism. And there were those who argued that solidarity with countries in Africa and throughout what we then called the Third World, that these were not feminist causes. Those were the debates that were happening then. But what I would like to emphasize is the changing meaning of feminism. Oftentimes people ask me, and I was just asked today at the press conference, why I did not associate myself with feminism at an earlier era. As a matter of fact, the first book that I wrote that focused on feminist issues was called Women, Race, and Class. But I did not consider myself a feminist then, because I, when people ask me whether I was a feminist, I would say, no, I am a revolutionary black woman. Because I didn't see at that time that the two could come together. But let me say, I think this would be an appropriate point to point out that there are those who assume that feminism is only about women, or that it is primarily about women, or if it's not about women, it's about gender. But I think that over the decades, the theoretical contributions, especially of women of color, we have come to recognize that feminism is not about so much about identity, or about the object we are trying to understand women, the object we're studying or around which we organize activist campaigns, but rather it is about how we organize. It is about how we engage in research. It is about the methods of our research. It is about the methodologies of our organizing. And it is a methodology that can be adopted by anyone, regardless of the acknowledged gender of the person doing the work. I would say that feminism is about subjecting everything to critical analysis. It is about thinking things together that have always been thought separately. It is about complicating our analyses in ways that allow us to more deeply understand. It is about scholarly analyses, but it is also about translation. And it is about not proposing simplistic ideas to people who may not have been exposed to high education because of the assumption that they do not have the intelligence or the capacity to understand complicated notions. But rather, it is about the confidence that almost anyone can learn and can recognize that if we do not think race and class and gender and sexuality and nation together, we will never begin to apprehend the world in all of its messy interrelationalities. In its, and I'll use this word, which is very much associated with feminism, in its many intersectionalities, but I'm using it outside of the context of identity. It is about recognizing the need to unveil the power of ideology and to never forget how ideology expresses itself. It is about recognizing that ideology resides in the most normal occurrences of our lives. As a matter of fact, it is about constituting the normal. The more normal something appears to be, you can be certain the more ideological it is. And so I say this to refer back to that era that I was discussing, the era that witnessed the rise of Black Lives Matter. The Dream Defenders is an organization in Florida. It's a radical, socialist, feminist organization of youth that came together initially as a response to the 2021 murder of Trayvon Martin. They have led several important delegations to Palestine, perhaps have been instrumental in the turn toward Palestine in the Black movement. Now, I wish I had the time to continue to kind of imagine a genealogy of the impact of feminism and the changing meaning of feminism in relation to Black liberation movements. If I did, of course, the genealogy would accord a very central place to Black feminist poet June Jordan, whom some of you may have read. There was a time when she was the most published Black person in the United States. And her poetry is remarkable. I urge you to read it. But I want to spend a couple of minutes on her because she was one of the first Black individuals to insist on justice for Palestine. And in the Palestine Solidarity Movement, she's known for her courageous political support of justice for Palestine when few people in the U.S. were willing to stand up against Zionism, and particularly they were particularly unwilling to challenge the U.S.-Israel alliance. And I mention this because I have spoken about her in the past, and I have talked about the fact that according to June Jordan, Palestine was not simply one cause among many in the world, but rather it was a moral litmus test for us all. And I have to be very careful because, later I see that gets reported as Angela Davis says Palestine is a moral litmus test. And I learned that from my sister comrade, June Jordan. If we are not prepared to think critically about what is happening in Gaza, and also, of course, the West Bank and East Jerusalem, if we simply imbibe the analysis forthcoming from Israeli and its closest ally, the U.S., as it seems that the leadership of so many universities in the United States has done, and I'm very sad to learn that you're confronting a similar situation here in Croatia. But maybe I'm wrong. Maybe Croatia is on the verge of recognizing Palestine. But if I am, I would appreciate it if someone would share the information with me, because I don't want to go back to the U.S. and talk about my visit to Croatia and say that while I found among the people here this really remarkable affinity with the struggle to build solidarity for Palestine, I didn't necessarily see it in the government. Am I right? Okay. I mean, I know I would have to stay here much longer in order to get a full picture. But it makes me very sad, particularly since Slovenia is about to recognize Palestine. Or has already? A couple of days ago, okay. And we know that Ireland recently announced that it would acknowledge Palestine, and Spain and Norway. And I was recently in Barcelona. I think it was even last week. And I can't tell you how comfortable it felt at a university in Spain with the chancellor of the university participating in the discussion. Talking about what needed to be done in order to, render the campaign for solidarity with Palestine more visible. That is not what we are confronting in the U.S. But you see, I told you I was going to veer away from my script. I was actually trying to talk about why June Jordan argued that Palestine is a litmus test. Because I think what she was referring to was that we're not, if we don't think deeply about the settler colonial state of Israel and the historical effort to prevent Palestinians from moving in the direction of freedom, we will not only be unprepared to understand and address the issues, the cluster of issues, the many issues emerging out of the current crisis, including, you know, for example, the assumption that that a nation state constitutes the path toward liberation. I'll just say, here I go again, veering away from my notes. When James Baldwin visited Israel in the early 1960s, I believe, his remark was something like, can a state and a language provide the answer to, you know, how to avoid the repetition of such horrendous violence as occurred during the Second World War and the Holocaust. So I think even as we talk about the importance of recognizing Palestine, we should simultaneously also think about the implications of couching the recognition of Palestine in the form of the recognition of a nation state. And so I was talking about the fact that if we don't think deeply about Palestine, and if we don't, we will not only be unprepared to understand and address all of the many issues emanating from the current crisis, but it will say something about our inability to understand the world around us. You know, whether here in Croatia, inside the US, or in relation to the many struggles for justice and freedom all over the globe. I mean, I think June Jordan was absolutely correct. How we align our solidarities in relation to Palestine says a great deal about our capacity to respond to complex contemporary issues of imperialism, settler colonialism, global racism, and this is something that Europe really needs to focus on, because despite the changes that have occurred over the centuries, Europe still imagines itself as white, and that is certainly an instance of ideological incapacity to grasp realities. I was actually going to say ideological blindness, and then I caught myself because we use so many words in our everyday conversations that are ableist, and we don't think about the impact on the disabled movement. Now, why is it that we're asked to believe that to criticize the Israeli state is equivalent to anti-Semitism? Why can we not see that to be in solidarity with those who have suffered one of the great historical tragedies is also to follow the leadership of those who have learned not to replicate, even unintentionally, the violence of those who created this tragedy? Along with many others, I have very deep respect for the Jewish leaders of the resistance to Israel as it continues to enact a systematic genocide on the people of Gaza. In our attempt to generate solidarity for this struggle to end the war on Gaza, indeed to end the occupation of Palestine, we follow the lead of our Palestinian comrades, and we embrace and follow the lead of our Jewish comrades in many other parts of the world who are leading the movement for a principled solidarity with Palestinian people. Principled solidarity is never transactional. We stand with those who are striving to create conditions for the flourishing of life because it is the right thing to do. We challenge and criticize and say no to those who promote hierarchies of life, who insist that certain populations deserve to be prioritized over others, that it is more important to support Europeans than Africans, to support white people rather than people of color, Jewish people rather than Muslims and Arabs. And parenthetically, many of us have long insisted on the deep kinship between Zionism and racism, going back to the 1975 UN resolution that examined the kinship of Zionism and racism. In this context, let me evoke another powerful writer, organizer, activist, Elizabeth Bettina Martinez, one of the great Latina feminist organizers in the US, who warned us not to be misled by arguments asserting that one community of people was more oppressed than another. She asked us not to capitulate to what she called oppression Olympics, and to recognize that those who are subject to racism and other modes of oppression should seek to dismantle all such hierarchies. And we realize that the US and Israeli government and the ideologies they promote attempt to normalize human hierarchies that are designed to justify war and state terror. And we do this by developing an awareness of the intersectional character of all of our struggles for justice, their indivisibility, their connections, and above all, an awareness that change is possible, an awareness that the future does not have to replicate the past. The Zionist leadership of Israel is deeply conservative. That is to say, it does not want progress toward a more habitable future for all. Present-day Zionism represents the continuation of strategies so central historically and today to settler colonialism. The war on the people of Gaza represents the intensification of these settler colonial strategies. And we know that Israel's most consistent ally has been the United States. And that both countries are perfect examples of what you might call collective narcissism. And every year, there are those in the US who call for increased support for the Israeli military. And you know, of course, that those weapons that are being used against Gaza have been funded by the US for many, many years. These two major capitalist nations are determined to retain hegemony militarily and ideologically. As someone who, along with others, has helped to develop theories and strategies of abolition with respect to the prison industrial complex and other institutions relying on the proliferation of carcerality in our lives, we have learned so much from the Palestinian freedom struggle. And I'm certain that we would not have achieved the current situation of vast numbers of people, at least in the US, being willing to seriously consider abolitionist approaches with respect to prisons, with respect to the police, with respect to border control, with respect to, you know, what we call the family policing system, which is otherwise known as the child welfare system, et cetera. And that feminist concerns about gender violence cannot rely on the violence of organized policing, which clearly reproduces the violence we think we are contesting. We've learned a great deal from the Palestinians. We've learned, for example, that we have to think more capaciously about carceral systems. The pervasive carcerality of Palestinian life in Gaza, in East Jerusalem, and of course in the West Bank warned us early on that we could not seriously consider ankle bracelets and house arrest as alternatives to imprisonment. By looking at Gaza, we become familiar with the concept of open air prisons and recognize that we cannot embrace any so-called alternatives to incarceration that simply involve the migration of carcerality from prisons to the larger community. The situation in Palestine has helped us to more effectively comprehend what was happening in our schools, where carceral technology began to overtake the importance of learning and teaching. We learned within the context of global capitalism, the same corporate security companies that were responsible for the technology of surveillance and punishment in Palestine were deeply embedded in the same processes in the US and in many other parts of the world. So I could offer you many other examples in this context, but I would like to gesture towards the Palestinian origins, at least in part, of a major insight that has brought radical clarity to a movement that has helped to define the Black liberation struggle for many decades. Now, thanks to the recognition that the Israeli army, the same IDF that is justifying daily strikes on civilians in Gaza, has been, as I pointed out, involved in the training of US police all over the country, including campus police, including university police, and of course not only in the US. So we began to understand the centrality of Israel in the militarization of police forces more broadly. This meant that it became easier to argue that as we could not simply focus on individual police, but rather had to shift our focus to the systems and the structures of policing. You may remember the shifts occasioned by the battles in Ferguson and the mass conversation around the police murder of Michael Brown. The shift from individual to structural, from individual to systemic, and the shifts occasioned by the battles in the shift occasioned by the creation of a massive solidarity campaign and the centrality of Palestine to that campaign. All of this culminated in the summer of 2020 and the response to the police murders of George Floyd and Breonna Taylor and too many others. And that was a conjuncture was responsible for elevating movements against racism and against heteropatriarchy to a new level. Now we talk about structural racism, and people recognize that we can no longer go back to the assumption that racism emanates from the ideas and attitudes of individuals, and the way to guarantee that we begin to wipe out racism is to assure that individuals learn how not to be racist. Maybe attend an unlearning racism workshop or something like that. But we know now what should have been acknowledged at the very end of slavery and the effort to reconstruct the society, the structural character of racism should have been acknowledged then. It wasn't simply about getting rid of the institution of slavery, it was also about the ways in which every single major institution in the society was deeply infected by racism. And I think I'll end here. There's so much more to say, but let me just one final word. I think this is important. As we mourn the violence in Gaza, as we try to forge solidarity, we know that the world we want, from the Americas to the Middle East, from Asia to Africa, from Europe to Australia, is a future in which the machinery of war will have been rendered obsolete. And racial capitalism, with its persistent human and animal hierarchies, its outmoded styles of punishment, its structures of policing, its sustained assaults on the environment that reproduce rather than minimize violence, will have become relics of the past. So this is why we mourn together. This is why we dream together. This is why we struggle together. This is why we call for an immediate ceasefire. This is why we exclaim together, Palestine will be free. Thank you.
Thank you, Angela, for this thought-provoking, very rich, very nourishing talk. This was really impressive, and I think it has sparked our intellectual curiosities even more. We've been really ex-nervous prepping this conversation with you, and there are so many questions we'd like to ask. But just to kind of scaffold this for us and for the audience, we're going to ask Angela a few questions here on the stage. But let's come back to Palestine, and thank you so much for centering so much of your talk around Palestine and Palestinian solidarity. Here we have an honor to sit with a number of Palestinians who fought for liberation of Palestine during the non-aligned movement. They're here with us. They form the International Club of Student Solidarity. We're also here in a space with Free Palestine Initiative from Croatia and from the other parts of the region. So I think this is really impressive to have this synergy over here. On the other hand, as you noticed in your talk, Croatian government is definitely not pro-Palestinian. It's quite anti-Palestinian, pro-Israeli. Doesn't really think of recognizing Palestine unless it is almost completely erased. And so we are fighting against that. So let me try to ask this question. Recently, in a conversation with Mesna Kato, a beautiful Palestinian-American scholar, she said, "The world needs Palestine more than Palestine needs the world." There is something so unsettling in her words. And I would like to ask you if you could share your thoughts about what is what is emerging? What possibilities are emerging in this very political moment when so much of our spaces, political, academic, media spaces, are so sanitized and censored? And what and how of Palestine can we, should we, are called to keep alive, to mobilize, to revive as well? And what is Palestinian resistance teaching us? And maybe I'm coming back here to the final part of your talk. What is it teaching us, and how does it turn our gaze and connect us with indigenous populations in the US and elsewhere, like Kashmir, when it comes to fighting settler colonial structures and apartheid regimes so much imbricated or entangled with racial capitalism?
Well, perhaps I should begin by saying that my first contact with the movement for a free Palestine was when I was an undergraduate at a university that was founded in the same year as the State of Israel, at a university that deeply identified with the project of Israel. And I like to point out the fact that I learned Palestine solidarity from my Jewish classmates there. You know, because as we talk about the importance of expressing solidarity with Palestine, we have to figure out how to confront the very unfounded charges of anti-Semitism, as if one's disagreement with the policies of a state, of a government, can constitute anti-Semitism. I said that because I've been involved in the movement for a very long time. And you know, one of the most moving moments of my own incarceration, when I was in jail in 1970, 1971, 1972, was a message of solidarity that was signed by a long list of people who were imprisoned in an Israeli prison, and then smuggled out of that prison and brought into me, into my cell. I say that to point out that this movement has been around for a very long time. It's been around since the very beginning, since 1948. And you know, one of the ways in which Palestine resonates with people who are oppressed all over the world is precisely because of their persistence, their persistent resistance. All of which is to say that resistance has happened in spaces that were not greatly publicized. It has grown and it has developed in isolation from other struggles, especially in the U.S. This is not the case in South Africa. This is not the case in, you know, many countries in the world. But in the U.S., it's been marginalized, and those who have supported Palestine have been subjected to McCarthyist strategies of losing jobs and of being told that they cannot teach a particular subject related to Palestine in the universities. So let me get to the real point that I'm trying to make. So it did not seem for so many years that it was going to be possible to incorporate Palestine into a larger social justice agenda. So that in our struggles against racism, against heteropatriarchy, whatever campaigns in the environment, that we would be inclusive. Palestine always existed as a separate source of knowledge and solidarity and organizing. However, I would say around the time of the Ferguson protests, many people began to talk about how it might be possible to break through that effort to marginalize Palestine. And a long, very long story short, at this particular moment, even amidst all of the tragedy and violence and sorrow, we see a vibrant movement to free Palestine, literally all over the country. From the support of Aboriginal people in Australia to Asia and Africa, and of course South Africa has taken the position of representing Palestine at the World Court. So, all of which is to say, even though it has taken decades and decades, I think that we've finally been able to break the power of Zionism, at least with respect to appealing to young people. There are encampments. There were 180 encampments on university campuses, and probably even more. This was some weeks ago that we counted the number of encampments. The elections will probably reveal this growing support for Palestine that some people never imagined. I think it's unfortunate that it had to happen amid so much violence and so much pain and so much suffering. But there is hope and there is joy, even as there is sorrow and there is grief. I think this is a new conjuncture with respect to people's involvement in the struggle to free Palestine.
Okay, let's move to the second one. You did tackle in your talk the limits of the nation state, but maybe we can broaden the argumentation on that matter. So the right to self-determination for ethnic and national groups, while historically also being a project of the left with emancipatory ambitions, can also be used in the service of political regimes that lead towards ethno-nationalism. Nationalism in all its forms, even when supported by progressive forces, is historically also tied to oppressive capitalist and other productivist nation states and multinational state projects. In the end, fails to achieve emancipatory for everybody. How would you, maybe?
Well, that is a complicated question, but I think you're absolutely right nationalism is the worst, is the source of the worst kinds of developments. And there's a sense in which people assume that the nation state is the only way to organize human populations. But as a matter of fact, this is a relatively new mode of organization. And so I think what I will do in answering your question is to draw on abolitionist organizing, in which we encourage people to engage in the work of the imagination, not to become so ensconced in the institutions that exist that we cannot see beyond them. Even today, when we can't really expect that the nation state is going to fall, we can nevertheless ask questions about what it might mean to imagine, for example, punishment outside the context of the nation state, to reimagine ways of developing modes of justice. And perhaps we can also engage in projects of refiguring what it might mean to live in a different world, even as we inhabit this one. So in abolitionist circles, we encourage people to recognize the extent to which we all we all do the work of the state. We all internalize ideologies of the state. And so to recognize that we not only have to get rid of the particular institution that is doing that work explicitly, but that we also have to recognize that we assent to that, and we oftentimes incorporate those strategies in our own emotional responses. With respect to punishment issues and abolition, there are those who say that they want to end retributive punishment. We want new forms of justice. But if they don't address the fact that their emotional propensity will be to try to do something bad to someone who has done something bad to them, if they don't recognize that as an ideological product of the very system of punishment they are trying to get rid of, we will never move in that direction. So I think the work of the imagination, what would it mean to be able to live in a world that is not defined by all of the institutions linked and ideologies linked to the state? Yeah.
Thank you. I think we still have some time. Okay, you talk about anti-capitalist feminism, but what kind of feminism is abolitionist feminism? And you actually mentioned in your talk that gender-based violence won't be solved by introducing more efficient anti-violence laws or harsher prison sentences. But what are the responses of the feminist abolitionist perspective to domestic violence, for example? In what way does gender, along with race and class, structure the prison system, and how viable are the abolitionist alternatives?
First of all, we generally use the term abolition feminism. And that has both a broad meaning, and it also has a very specific connection to gender violence. And the connection to gender violence is based on an analysis that by simply sending perpetrators to prison, one not only does not begin to reduce gender violence in the world, but as a matter of fact, it might be responsible for increasing it. Given the connection between institutional violence and intimate violence, and the ways in which both tend to be responsible for the reproduction of the other. What we say is that there's no easy solution, and imprisonment has always been the easy solution. It's never been about actually producing a world in which those violences gender violence is the most prevalent violence in the world, in which gender violence and other violences are reduced. Gender violence is, it proliferates behind bars. If one, you know, looks at the prevalence of rape in men's prisons and the use of rape in men's prisons to control the prison population, if one looks at the degree to which guards engage in sexual abuse against women prisoners, prisons only guarantee the perpetuation of the violence that we think that we are addressing by sending perpetrators to do time behind bars. You know, prisons are capitalists. And they emerge, prisons as punishment emerge precisely at the time when capitalism develops and bourgeois democracy, capitalist democracy. So you might argue that prisons are a source of all of the contradictions and the problems that we see in capitalist notions of democracy, this assumption that there's an instantaneous fix, that you know you send somebody to prison to do time for the crime that they're committed, and that's going to make the world better. And as a matter of fact, it usually ends up making it worse. And what it actually ends up doing is directing our attention away from more productive ways of addressing these social problems. How can we deal with gender violence? It's a very complicated question, given the fact that it's embedded in the heteropatriarchal world in which we live. The more interesting experiments in trying to address gender violence without the use of the police, I think, are much more fruitful ways of understanding or imagining possible future ways of hopefully eventually rendering obsolete that kind of gender violence. But the prison only serves as a force that will clearly replicate that violence. In a book that I did with three other scholar activists called Abolition Feminism, which is what you were talking about, we try to address some of the experiments that have happened in various places. You know, what does it mean to establish a community as a community that's free of the intervention of the police? You know, how do you develop community modes of addressing gender violence and other forms of harm? You know, how can you, you know, for example, create ways of dealing with people who are having mental breakdowns? And I don't know whether that's the case here in Croatia, but the police are the people who are called if someone is having a crisis. There is something online that, if people are interested in this, a very interesting analysis and a projection of certain possible strategies created by an organization that was called Generation 5. And it still exists on the internet. If you If you Google Generation 5, you see plans for an effort to eradicate violence over five generations. So the assumption is that it will take at least that long, at least five generations. So what does it mean to engage in activism today to promote new ways of thinking about violence that when you will have long passed away by the time they come to fruition? Generation 5 is an organization that brought together abusers and those who were abused to try to figure out what has to be done in this long-range strategy. So this is not a capitalist strategy. Capitalists don't like to wait longer than what the market might produce next year. And so in this book, Abolition Feminism Now, we look at some of the organizations that have done experimental work like that, that may not have lasted very long, but that have left the important traces of their ways of reimagining efforts to eventually eradicate from this earth violence and gender violence and other modes of destruction. And yeah, it's, I think what I like about it is that it's realistic. Mm-hmm. It's realistic to say that it is going to take five generations to rid our world of gender violence. It's realistic to say it's going to be really complicated. It's going to involve collective work. It's going to involve individual work. It's not realistic to say that all you do is send the perpetrator to a prison where the perpetrator can completely forget about what it is they have done and continue business as usual. But I don't know, sometimes we have to do it that way. We have to engage in practices that will produce knowledge as we go along. What we may not necessarily know now, we will know better if we start to do it, even though we may not know what we're doing. Because we can't always assume that the answer is there, and we can arrive at it simply through exercises of the mind. We have to engage in the work, do the work, make mistakes, and we'll be in a different place someday.
Thank you so much.
Predavanje profesorice Angele Davis održana je u suradnji s Verzi festivala Multimedijalnog instituta MAMA I knjiženog kluba Books. Sister,